This week's episode of The Random Show is brought to you by Sonos. Go to sonos.com/random.
Welcome to The Random Show, Dirty Dozen, number 12. This is Tim Ferriss.
And I'm Kevin Rose. Welcome. We are at a crazy place that was your idea, Trampoline House. What is the name of it?
This is the House of Air SF, houseofairsf.com. And
I'm very excited. I just can't wait to finish this podcast because I got there and freaking jump on the trampolines.
I found this on SFist, I think it was, .com, looking at different sites for activities in SF. This popped up, brand new space, and we just found out that one of the co-owners apparently just found this out, left his last job partially due to the four-hour work week. So
that's here we are,
which is awesome. But wait until you see this place. It's amazing. So we'll be doing some jumps.
Awesome.
In the meantime,
let's have a little bet since we haven't done it yet. Who's going to do the better trampoline move?
Okay, I'll bet on myself.
So you think you're going to pull it off?
I think I'll pull off something.
Can you do like double back flips and shit like that or what?
No. No.
Something tells me you got some crazy moves.
I have some moves.
You're a break dancer. That's probably
I have some moves and I have less instinct for self-preservation.
I think Glenn can pull some stuff off.
So the discussion was earlier. To quote Kevin, he said, "I can jump on a trampoline like a motherfucker." So if we're using it in the Pulp Fiction sense, that means you must be pretty good.
We'll see. It's been years.
All right.
You know, but I used to do a lot of that when I was younger.
So updates, man. What's the latest?
Not much. Hired a CEO at Dig, Matt Williams. He has started full time officially as of like 2 weeks ago. He just had a kid a couple days ago. So congrats, Matt. But he is so he's been out of the office for that. But very excited to actually have a full time CEO on board, running Dig, and it makes my life a lot easier.
Imagine. Got a lot to do.
Yeah, I mean the last 6 months have been crazy. You know, ever since we lost Jay, who was our last CEO, it's just been a lot of work. You know, the role of a CEO is just one of a cheerleader and one of a motivator and one that's resolving conflicts. And, you know, there's a whole slew of things that go into that job. And at the scale and size that Dig is, it's just a job that I really never... I can't say I would never want that job. If I were to have that job, I would want to start over.
Yeah. Right.
And, like, you know, build your own culture, your own team from the ground up.
Right.
Versus being thrown into that role.
Yeah.
Because, you know, people know, they've seen me as the founder of Dig, and, you know, they think that I had everything to do with the direction and area and, you know, people we hired and things like that. Those decisions were largely made by other people.
Yeah.
Especially hiring decisions, setting the culture. I definitely weighed in on a lot of that stuff, but you know, it's one of those things where I think if you're a CEO from day one, you can do what you want in the way that, there's definitely some things I would have done differently.
Right.
But you know, that's all a process of learning and maturing as an entrepreneur.
Ripening.
So, ripening.
Coming into season.
That's right.
Anything else going on? Big plans coming up?
Traveling, doing a bunch of speaking stuff. So Tahoe in a week. Doing a talk out there, and then going to doing a Paris Le Web for a conference in December.
Yeah,
are you going to be out there for that?
I might be. I have no idea. I was there last year. I had a lot of fun. I was only in Paris for 12 hours, roughly.
Yeah.
That was rough because I forgot my passport, and I had to fly out last minute. But I'd like to spend more than one day
in Paris. Dude, you should come out. That'd be amazing.
Yeah, it'd be fun.
What's up with you? You finished your book?
Yeah. So this is big news. The last round of edits, meaning my last round of edits, just went in on Friday, this past Friday. All right. So I have one more round of fine-tuning, and then it should be off to the printer. So I brought something to show you. But if you hate it, you can't tell me. You have to pretend like you like it anyway.
Right, is it the cover or something?
Yeah.
Oh, God damn it.
So I'll show you first.
Oh, shit.
So one moment. So, you can see here, this is, I'm going to explain what this is on the back. So, we can get a better shot of this.
That's awesome.
But, so the title, the real title, is The 4-Hour Body. And you can see the subtitle, which was tested, and we'll go into the testing. is An Uncommon Guide to Rapid Fat Loss, Incredible Sex, and Becoming Superhuman.
That's the one I voted on.
Yeah, right?
He sent out an email saying, like, vote on your you know, favorite title. Did you get that, Glenn?
I did.
Yep.
Which one did you pick?
You didn't pick that? Dude, how could you not pick that title?
So it was very split. It showed the importance of sample size. So initially I tested with about 50 people, came back.
Friends?
About 50 friends, a couple marketers that I know closely, and got two answers. And then I tested much more widely with about 500, and then I went up to a few thousand. And
sex always wins, dude.
Sex does win. You need the sample size, though. You cannot trust just a handful. It's very important to look at the statistical significance.
You said other as well. And I gave you one. What was mine?
I have no idea. You can say no.
I really don't remember.
It was okay. My best memory of what you put in was something like, I have a huge cock. That is some bullshit title. Anyway, sorry, but that's what it was.
It was something like, I think it might have said,
I was
joking with that one. I give you two times.
So, hey, all right, put me on the spot. So, this is, so these are swatches. So basically trying to decide exactly which colors to use for the cover. You can see that you get to look
at
Pantones.
Like Pantone,
these are the Pantones. So be curious to know, which do you think would be better for the figure on the front?
The sparkler, the better. It's like a fishing lure.
You think so?
Oh, hell yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Okay. I'll let you guys take a quick look at this.
It catches your eye.
The sparkly or the not so sparkly? For this part.
For what part?
For this part. For that guy.
Oh yeah, for that guy for sure. You want a little.
What do you think, Glenn Bob?
I like the sparkly.
You do.
Okay, yeah, you do. You want the light to reflect off it when they're walking by the aisle.
Right now.
So by the time you guys see this, the book will probably be on BNN, Amazon, and so forth. Still has a while to ship, but it will be up with much more detail. So super excited about that, and you will, dear Kevin,
finally get
a copy. He's like, send me a digital copy. I'm like,
dude, he will not email me a copy.
I know.
Dude, I'm not going to send it to anybody.
It's just
on BitTorrent.
I'll send you. You will get a copy.
When will I get it?
Lock and key. Probably the next 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks. Once it's edited up, because I made a lot of edits on this last round, and it's the second time I've done it by hand. I did it on a Word document, now second time. But enough on the book. Super excited. Been working on it for 3 years. That's the biggest update. Finally getting to focus on a lot of the PR and marketing, which is going to be amazing. I've had some really awesome interest so far from a couple of national magazines, and looking to do a lot with some of the people I did things with the first time around. And you know, the fact that they might be smaller bloggers or things like that doesn't faze me at all. I mean, I think that if this thing's going to work and stick for more than 2 weeks, like, you can buy your way onto the bestseller list. People don't like to talk about this. A lot of people do it. I'd say half of the books on the business bestseller list right now, New York Times, are bought on the list. It's a long story, but, like, it's a function of volume. So it's like, if you buy enough copies, you can have a list.
I know what you're talking about. Somebody told me about this. You buy a big chunk of them, like, to give out for promos and stuff right off the bat.
Yeah, so, I mean, there are people who spend, I mean, hundreds of thousands of dollars to do this. But in my particular case,
it's the same thing with the iTunes store.
Yeah, it's very similar. So if I want it to stick, but stick for years and sell and sell and sell and sell, the groundswell from the bottom up is really important. So I'm going to be doing a lot of fun stuff.
Sweet.
Okay. So,
speaking of books, I want to show you something you haven't seen yet.
All right.
This is a brand new Kindle.
Nice.
And the reason, it's funny, because on a couple of different podcasts I've been showing this around, and it must seem like I'm an ad for Kindle, but really I hated the old Kindles. I didn't hate them, they just were too bulky.
Yeah.
But dude, at $139, feel how tiny that thing is.
Yeah.
It's pretty awesome.
This feels like half the size of the one that I have, even though it's probably one generation ago.
I thought it was really cool. Are you going to release on Kindle, by the way?
Oh, yeah.
Right off the bat?
Not sure what the timing's going to be.
What's the kind of, like, cut? Like, give us the insider. Like, if you write a book, and let's say you charge $10 for it on the Kindle, how much of that do you actually see hit your pocket?
This is a good question. So the cut on Kindle, I'm not 100% sure, to be honest, because the total electronic sales for my book, including Kindle, to date have been 1.6%.
Oh, shit, it's
nothing. So I believe that I get a higher percentage. Might be getting myself in trouble, but I would say, speaking in general terms, not my contract, in general terms, if you have a hardcover book you'll be getting anywhere from 10 to 15% of cover price, mm-hmm. and that usually escalates with the number of copies you sell. So past a certain point, it's a flat, let's say 15%. For paperback, you get generally half of that. So there's a very good reason why I have never gone to paperback. It's because I would have to sell twice as many books to make the same amount of money.
Mm.
It doesn't make any sense. And I'm not in a rush to, let's say, get the readers who are not willing to spend $11, but they're willing to spend $8.
Six or whatever, yeah.
It doesn't make any sense. So I think the economics will change over time. But for the ebooks, you get marginally more, I believe. But the volume is still not there. And they don't count for the bestseller list, which is crazy.
Right, that is crazy.
Yeah.
One thing I did see, though, is that Amazon announced the first book that sold 1 million digital copies, which is pretty cool.
Wow.
That was the
fiction,
girl. Right? That was the red.
Stieg Larsson.
Red, yeah, tattoo girl. Right?
Yeah, so if you look at the best-selling authors on Kindle, they're almost all fiction. It's very difficult to find someone who sold more than, let's say, 100,000 copies digital. In nonfiction, extremely hard to find. Almost all of the top sellers are fiction. So the Kindle, you like the new Kindle?
Yeah, so speaking of books, let's talk about our book of the week.
Oh yeah, so we're
talking about it. So I've been reading a book, I'm about halfway through it. It's really, really good. Let me just go to my main menu here so I get the title right. Sorry, how do I go back to the main menu? Oh, there we go, home. It's called No Death, No Fear by Thich Han.
Oh, Thich Nhat Hanh.
Yeah, Thich Nhat Hanh. I never know how to spell his name. Or say his name.
Too many H's.
Thich Nhat Hanh, right?
I think. Vietnamese people help? Yeah, I think it's Thich Nhat Hanh.
So it's called No Death, No Fear. It's really. So he's basically a Buddhist monk.
Yeah.
And, like, I am not, like, Buddhist. If anything, like, when I was little, I was raised, like, Christian, and now I'm kind of, like, got my own messed up belief about all that kind of stuff. I don't want to go into religion, but yeah.
So there was a lot of goats.
One of the things that this book I thought was really interesting is they start talking about the notion that it does have some Buddhist ties to it, but one of the things that's really interesting is they talk about why Buddhist monks don't fear death.
Mm.
It's like why they have absolutely no fear of death. Like you've seen that famous picture of that Buddhist monk that doused himself in gasoline and lit himself on fire in protest and like didn't flinch.
Yeah.
Like, it was crazy.
Yeah.
So I was really fascinated by that, and I was sort of reading into it, and it was like, basically, they don't ever believe in birth. They don't believe that you were ever born.
Mm-hmm.
So what they believe is that essentially, like, all the atoms that we're made up of were something else before it. And
right.
So essentially they believe in, like, these streams of awareness.
Yeah.
So, like, we're aware now. When we pass away, we won't be aware for a while, but we may turn into a flower, you know, as our atoms and our body turns to ashes and goes back into the dirt. It becomes a worm or whatever it may be. They believe that, you know, you pass on and move in and out of different objects, which is freaking crazy. But it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
I don't know. It was just a really fascinating book. I got pulled in by the title, and I was like, and I've liked some of the stuff that he's had to say about mindfulness in the past.
Yeah.
And I'm a big fan of mindfulness, and I absolutely think it's helped me personally reduce stress in my life and just, like, sleep better and you name it. It's worked wonders. But, yeah, this is a really fascinating read.
No Death, No Fear.
No Death, No Fear. By Thich Nhat Hanh.
Thich Nhat Hanh.
But you don't have to be Buddhist to get into it. You know, it's just kind of one of these things where I like a lot of their principles.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I apply some of that stuff to my own life, and I think it was a really cool read so far.
Yeah, Thich Nhat Hanh, there's one book he wrote called, I think it's Peace is Every Step or Mindfulness is Every Step, which had a huge impact on me in terms of mindfulness. It's basically like... Is that right?
Miracle of Mindfulness? Is that what you're talking about?
No,
that is
one
of his really popular
something
ones,
every
too.
Step.
Mindfulness every step.
Yeah, and the anecdote that really stuck with me is that if while you're washing the dishes, all you're thinking about is the peach that you're going to enjoy when you finish the dishes, when you eat the peach, you'll be thinking of something afterwards,
right.
And you won't be enjoying the peach. And
right.
That just really stuck with me.
Right, absolutely. So for people that don't know what mindfulness is or they haven't read a whole lot about it, it's basically concentrating, like extreme focus on the present moment. So knowing exactly what you're doing and concentrating on that so that you're not off there wandering and worrying. A lot of these guys that write these books, not only Buddhist books, but about mindfulness in general, they claim that, you know, you can get rid of of fear and worrying and anxiety and stress and all these things by staying focused on the present moment.
Yep.
So a lot of what meditation is just focusing on the present moment. So just enjoying your surroundings or atmosphere at any given moment in time. It's really quite powerful stuff if you get into it.
Yeah, agreed. So on the Buddhist note, I think an exemplar of Buddhism, I have a gift for you.
Oh, nice.
And this is at once the book and the person I'm going to talk about. I want to put out a caveat, and that is that this book comes with a number of warnings.
Is this like one of those?
So, this is for you. Kevin's too nice, so this is a book called Assholes Finish First by Tucker Max, and I'll tell you why this is important. So,
thank you.
For you.
Can I get it on my Kindle?
You can probably get it. Actually, you can't get it on Kindle because this book hasn't come out yet.
Oh, really?
Awesome. Yeah, yeah. I think it'll be out by the time people see
this.
Do you
know this guy?
Yeah, so Tucker Max. Let me give the background here. So Tucker, I met at South by Southwest, my first South by Southwest. He was doing a panel called From Blog to Book. And he was the only person, the single person, who read a galley of the book. He read it overnight. So I gave it to him after I went up and introduced myself following his panel, and he said, "Who the fuck are you?" He really is exactly as he comes across in the book. And all of his writing will insult you, and it's absolutely some of the most gut-wrenchingly funny but insulting reading that you will find. However, he's also one of the top five most brilliant marketers that I've ever met. So he read the galley. This is before anybody knew anything about it. And he sat down and he said, "Your book is going to be a New York Times bestseller. And let me tell you exactly how it's going to happen." And he laid it out, like, step by step, what the precursors would be and what it would lead up to. And then it hit the list. And he sent me a text and he was like, "You hit the list, motherfucker. We told you," or whatever. Pardon my cursing. But the point of it being, he's the only one who really specced it out. So his first book, I Hope They Serve Beer in Hell, number one New York Times bestseller, turned down by everybody, has been on the New York Times list in some fashion for, I think, 5 years.
Hmm.
And the point I wanted to make about this, I'm not going to go hugely into the book, just rest assured that it is extremely, extremely offensive. So if you're okay with that, check it out. Otherwise, you might want to look at something else. But the point I want to make about Tucker is that he's very, very rude, but the reason that I would take 10 Tuckers in my life versus many of the people I run into is he's extremely honest, he's extremely loyal to his friends, and he's very, very smart, and he's detail-oriented, and he's extremely reliable. And I think that, I was just thinking about this last week, that I think part of the reason is Americans have so much trouble getting things done, both on an individual level and collectively, if you look at us competing against China, which I think is kind of crazy, but let's just say that's the case, is because Americans are really easily insulted. They take a lot of things personally, and everybody ends up hedging. No one speaks to each other honestly. And in any case,
awesome.
If you're interested in seeing an extreme embodiment of someone who calls himself an asshole very rightly, Tucker Max is your guy.
I'll definitely give it a read. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Cool.
So, people.
Yes. Gosh, I don't have anyone this week. Okay. On the person front. Was Tucker Max your person and book?
Yeah, I think Tucker's a very interesting case study in not compromising, being very conflicted and controversial, but at the same time being extremely valuable to both his readers and other people. So I think Tucker's an interesting case study for people to look at because he confuses a lot of people. But if we don't have the people front, we could jump into websites, apps.
Yeah, let's do apps real quick.
Okay.
So I don't have a website, but I do have an app. And this one is called Chomp. So Chomp is pretty cool. Have you used Chomp?
No.
Chomp just came out with version 2.0. It's done by my friend Ben. And essentially what it is it allows you to go in and start rating the different applications that you've downloaded on for your iPhone or for your iPad. And then you can say, I like this app, I didn't like this app, I like this app, and then it builds a recommendation engine for you and starts recommending you apps.
Cool.
And then you can also follow, different people, like that they have, like, leaders, different, like, major tech people are on there that you can follow, like Veronica Belmont or you name it, and then see what apps they're liking.
Right.
And then it sends you notifications when your friends start liking apps. So, for example, I'll friend up a bunch of people, let's say Glenn's using it, and he's like, "Oh, I really enjoy this app," and it says, "I heart this app, save." I'll get a text to my phone, and all of his followers will get a text saying, like, he just liked this app. And if you have an iPhone, you're like, oh, hell yeah, because you don't know when to buy a new app or, like, when to get a good recommendation. So I think Apple's been needing this for a while. There's that top 100 apps that are out there,
right,
and a lot of them are games and things like that, but, like, more so than just, like, the reviews based on the Apple website, I trust my friends. There's certain people that I know that if they rate something, like, it's going to be a pretty damn good app. So I like the app. I think it's pretty awesome. It's free, and it's just a great way to get recommended apps.
So this is a... Do they have a lot of competitors, or no?
Not really. So this is
an idea, and this is meant as a compliment, that you hear and you go, wow, I'm amazed somebody hasn't thought about that already. You know what I mean? And I think that those are a lot of the best ideas. When you see these startups that pop up, like another one, Branch Out, I don't know if you saw this recently, they raised $6 million their first round. It's career networking on Facebook. So it's like LinkedIn on Facebook, and it's like, okay, like, why didn't somebody think about that? And I don't know. It's like a lot of these, this would be another example. That's pretty cool.
Oh, you know what I started using?
What's
that? Speaking of website, I'm going to do one real quick. That's freaking awesome. I think it's only TaskRabbit.
Yes.
So this is one that, before they were called TaskRabbit, they were called Run My Errand.
Mm-hmm.
And they got a hold of me because they were raising around the funding.
Yep.
And I was like, Run My Errand, I don't like the name. Because I'm weird. You know how I'm weird about names. Like, I like the name to sound cool and all that. And they changed it to TaskRabbit. I'm like, oh, that's a pretty cool name. And I was like, but will people really use it? Dude, I used it and it's awesome.
Yeah.
So my girlfriend's moving into my place.
Yeah. You know I'm an advisor, right?
Yes, I know you're an advisor. Right. I have no affiliation.
No, I know. I'm just full disclosure.
No, I'm talking personally why I like it.
Yeah.
I'm not an investor. I'm not an advisor or anything like that. I knew you were involved in some way. I didn't know if you invest or what. So basically what you do, and this is pretty cool, I went on there and I said, I need moving boxes, like, taken to my girlfriend's house during these times.
Yeah.
I'm busy as hell. I don't have time to go to U-Haul, freaking pick up some moving boxes, go down to her house, drop them off. I'd love to. But I just don't have time that day, you know? So I did that, boom, go. I got a text back like 10 minutes later, like, the task has been assigned. This person will do it for $10.
Yeah.
And it happened.
Yeah.
And then the other day I was like, shit, I need to get this letter certified. Sorry, I didn't spit on you. I need to get this letter certified at the post office.
Yeah.
And, like, you know what a pain in the ass it is to go and wait at the post office?
Pain. Yeah.
Dude, somebody came by my freaking office, took the letter, got it certified, brought it back, and brought me back the little receipt, and I paid like $10 to go get a letter certified.
Yeah.
It saved me so much time already. Yeah. It sucks that it's only available in, like, Boston, San Francisco.
Boston and SF. That's it right now.
Yeah. But they're expanding. It's cool. It's a really cool service.
Okay. So just to expand on that, again, I'm an advisor, but I'm really simplistic maybe in the way that I do a lot of my advising. I try to find companies that make stuff I want to use all the time so I can actually help them make the things I want to use.
You were smart in getting in Evernote. Evernote's freaking awesome.
Evernote's amazing, yeah. So TaskRabbit is another example. So just to give you an idea of the stuff that I've used TaskRabbit for, like, midnight runs to go get ice for me because I take ice baths because I'm a weirdo.
I'd use that for ice cream. When you said ice, I was like, oh, shit.
You can use it.
Ice cream until the morning.
I've been in a restaurant, and I'd be like, oh, my God, I need to overnight this, but I also need to do this other thing. And I'd have somebody come to the restaurant, pick it up, head off, again, like, get
That's
it overnighted
amazing.
Or certified and come back. Laundry, food, breaking down boxes.
Actually, like, baths that I don't like to take.
Right. It just goes on and on. It's really quite cool. And they're taking a very similar hyper-local approach that Zipcar did in sorts. So the two apps that I'm going to talk about that I'm pretty excited about are both related to art, actually. And not many people know this, but I wanted to be a comic book penciler for, like, I don't know, a decade?
Why don't you have any comic art on your walls than in your house?
I do. I have one. It's a painting, but it's comic art. It's more like Slaying the Horned God, sort of Simon Bisley type stuff. But so the two apps, these are iPad apps. Don't have an iPhone. The first is, I'll make it really short, and then we can show some B-roll of this, is Brushes, which I actually came across through Y Combinator. It's a painting app, but it's that doesn't do it justice. There have been, I think, 3 or 4 New Yorker covers done using Brushes, and the artist has just used his hand to make these covers, and they're amazing. You can see the time lapses. So, Glenn, hopefully we'll just show a quick time lapse of one of these. It's incredible. So that's been my excuse to get back into playing around with penciling. The other is called Graphically. So it's
graphic.ly. I'm an advisor to this company, but I'm a comic book nerd. I have like 10,000 plus poly bagged comic books.
I've got a ton as well.
Yeah, love comic books.
What's the best comic that you own?
Oh, man.
Like your favorite?
Best? You know, honestly, I would say this is a very little-known comic. The artwork and some of the story, Slain the Horned God. S-L-I-N-E, the Horned God. It's illustrated by Simon Bisley. It might be Beasley, but B-I-S-L-E-Y.
You know how you can get your comics graded, like, by CGC?
Yeah.
Where you send them in and they grade them, like,
yeah.
I have a 9.8, which is, like, really high. It's super ultra mint.
Yeah.
Wolverine number one.
Nice.
I mean, it's worth like $150, but it's still a pretty nice cool comic. Yeah.
I was really into Punisher, Wolverine, Jim Lee when he helped relaunch the X-Men. But graphically is a way to view and share comics. That's it. And you can do a lot of other stuff, but what's really cool about it, for me at least, is you can see, for example, the blue pencil, original sketches, how the comics were built up, comments from the artists and so forth. So we'll show some of that, but I just love comics, so those would be my two apps.
Dude, let's go jump on the trampoline.
All right, time to jump.
But one thing we want to say first, big thank you to Sonos, sonos.com/random, and for some deals there. And Sonos has been a supporter of ours for the last few episodes, and we are longtime users of their products. Great real-time streaming of Sirius satellite radio, freaking your iTunes collection.
Yep.
I use it all the time for Pandora, which is amazing. I have them throughout my house. You have them throughout your house. Glenn is going to get them. You have Sonos at your house yet?
No.
Oh, dude, we got to get you that.
And if you want to see, just as a side note, I always write and edit to Pandora. So if you want to see what I listen to, I think it's just pandora.com/Tim Ferriss or /people/Tim Ferriss. So you can see all the stuff I bookmarked there as well. So thank you, Sonos.
Thanks, Sonos. And we'll see you for the next Random Show soon.